Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above the heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
Good afternoon. My name is Mitch Davis, and on behalf of the Franklin Church of Christ in Franklin, Tennessee, I would like to welcome you to our Sunday afternoon worship service. May God richly bless your soul today.
Would you pray with me, please? Our Father, we thank you for this day and for this time that we can stop on the first day of the week to remember that your Son made the ultimate sacrifice by laying down his life for our sins. And by your power, you raised him up to make all our hopes possible in this world and the hope in the world to come. Father, we offer prayer for our leaders and all who are in authority so that we may all live quiet and tranquil lives. This is so that we have the opportunity to spread the good news of your Son. You desire every person to hear the good news and to be saved. We ask, Lord, that you would take this virus, this coronavirus, away, that you would comfort those who have been affected by it, and so many families who have been affected by it. We pray for healing for all who have been affected by it. And we thank you, Lord, because our hope is in you, whatever we may face in this life is overcome by the knowledge that we have a home to look forward to in heaven with you. Lord, as we meet together to study your word, to pray and to sing, we hope these things glorify your name. In Jesus' name, amen.
On a hill far away stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame. And I love that old cross where the dearest and best for a world of lost sinners was slain. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. Oh, that old rugged cross, so despised by the world, has a wondrous attraction for me. For the dear Lamb of God left his glory above to bear it to dark Calvary. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. To that old rugged cross I will ever be true, its shame and reproach gladly bear. Then he'll call me someday to my home far away, where his glory forever I'll share. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross
Hello, brothers and sisters. I hope you're having a blessed Sunday. I want to share a few thoughts before we partake of the Lord's Supper. While on the cross, Jesus only spoke a few words. Each statement was very powerful and should give us hope. One of the first statements was from Luke 23:34. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. What were the effects of this prayer on those around the cross? On the soldiers who did the crucifixion, it made no impression at all. They were blind to the glory and wonder of the scene. On the Sanhedrin, it had a very peculiar effect. Christ's perfect goodness and spiritual beauty threw them into a convulsion of angry opposition. His friends who stood afar off knew nothing about Christ's victory over sin and death, and it appeared to them as a tragic defeat. Jesus' first word, Father, indicates that the natural language of Jesus was prayer. It also showed that his faith was unshaken by all he had endured and was now passing through. When the fortunes of Jesus were the bleakest and he was baited by a raging pack of wolf-like enemies, and when he was in the abyss of pain and desertion, he could still say, Father. It seemed as if the hand of the Creator was withdrawn from the rudder of the universe. What good could come out of this unfathomable wrong? The salvation of the world came out of it. The noblest lesson in all of history came out of it. The supreme lesson to Christians everywhere to never despair came out of it. God still rules and will bring right to the rule once more. This prayer from the cross is nothing short of amazing. His enemies had insulted him in every possible way. The high priest twisted the law around him. Herod disdained him. Pilate played fast and loose with him. The mob howled at him. Our own hearts burned with indignation against them. But Jesus said, Father, forgive them. He taught men in the Sermon on the Mount to love your enemies, bless them that curse you, do good to them that hate you, and pray for them that despitefully use you and persecute you. Men have considered this morality as a beautiful dream and almost never have practiced it. But Jesus practiced what he taught. All the life of Jesus, he was revealing the God that was in him. And now, with his short time left, he revealed the very highest of God in him. The Father was in him all of his life on earth, but on the cross, the divine flame burned brightly as never before. When he said, Father, forgive them, he told them, God is love. The injured in this world see only their side of the case, but when the pain was greatest inflicted by his enemy, Jesus sought to excuse their conduct. He knew, however, that they needed forgiveness because they were guilty. Also, by praying that his enemies be forgiven, Jesus drove back evil spirits of anger and revenge, which tried to force their way into his heart and preserve the serenity of his soul. What a wonderful example for us today. We'll now have a moment to prepare for the partaking of the Lord's Supper. Let us offer thanks for the bread. Our Heavenly Father, thank you for sending your Son to the earth on our behalf. As we partake of this bread, let us do so with a reverent heart and a joyful spirit. He was broken on the cross that we might live. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let us offer thanks for the cup. Father, we again approach that throne of grace and mercy, thanking you for the great sacrifice on our behalf. As we partake of this cup of the fruit of the vine, which represents the shed blood of our Savior, we are grateful beyond words. Please help us grow closer to you each day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
every hour, most gracious Lord. No tender voice like thine can peace afford. I need thee, oh, I need thee. Every hour I need thee. Oh, bless me now, my Savior. I come to thee. I need thee every hour. Stay thou nearby. Temptations lose their power when thou art nigh. I need thee, oh, I need thee. Every hour I need thee. Oh, bless me now, my Savior. I come to thee. I need thee every hour, most holy one. Oh, make me thine indeed, thou blessed Son. I need thee, oh, I need thee. Every hour I need thee. Oh, bless me now, my Savior. I come to thee.
The Lord's my shepherd, I'll not want. He makes me down to lie.
In pastures green, he leadeth me.
In pastures green, he leadeth me. The quiet waters by, my soul he doth restore again, and me to walk doth make.
Within the paths of righteousness,
within the paths of righteousness, e'en for his own name's sake. Yea, though I walk in death's dark veil, yet will I fear none ill.
For thou art with me and thy rod.
For thou art with me and thy rod, and staff me comfort still. My table thou hast furnished in presence of my foes.
My head thou dost with oil anoint.
My head thou dost with oil anoint, and my cup overflows. Goodness and mercy all my life shall surely follow me. House forevermore, my dwelling place shall be.
Genesis 50, verses 19 through 21, from the New King James Version. Joseph said to them, "Do not be afraid, For am I in the place of God? But as for you, you meant evil against me, but God meant it for good, in order to bring it about as it is this day, to save many people alive. Now, therefore, do not be afraid. I will provide for you and your little ones. And he comforted them and spoke kindly to them.
Hey there, family. Today is going to be a great Lord's Day, okay? Today we're going to talk about God's sovereignty and God's providence. Now, those are two things that a lot of people may not have a lot of understanding about, but trust, if God's children get a chance to understand God's sovereignty and God's providence, it will help us stay sane. In a time like this, we need as much sanity as possible, right? So, thank you once again, as I said, Brother Arrowwood, for reading that passage. We're in Genesis chapter 50, verse 19 through 21. And before you read that, let us talk about these two phrases for a second, God's sovereignty and God's providence. So, God's sovereignty is, as I have it in my notes, is what he wants to happen, okay? God's sovereignty is what he wants to happen. God has a plan, God has a way of doing things, and think about it, God's sovereignty was erasing the whole earth with a flood. God's sovereignty was sending one man to take all the punishment for man's sin. That's God's sovereignty. He gets the choice and the ability to do that. The book of Job and Jonah really illustrate God's sovereignty. But God's providence is this. It's where God sets things up and connects them so that his sovereignty does happen. For example, God's sovereignty when he was with Jonah was for Jonah to go to Nineveh and to tell them that God is upset with them. Jonah knew God's sovereignty. Jonah knew that God was great and that God would do whatever he wanted to do. But Jonah also knew God's providence. By being a prophet and a man of God, Jonah knew that God's main goal in life is not to kill creation, but to bring creation back to him. And so Jonah was very upset with the fact that I'm going to have to go to these people that can potentially kill me, and not only can potentially kill me, but have killed and abused all of my brothers and sisters that they possibly could. And I know that when I go over there and I tell them how great of a God you are and how upset you are with them, you're more than likely going to try your best to save them. Nah, I don't want to do that. So he hops on the boat. I mean, he does all types of stuff, and I don't want to get too much into his story because we're talking about Joseph today. But understand that God's sovereignty and God's providence are all the time met by God's children. It's just sometimes we don't understand it, or we don't want it to go that way based off our own human, fleshly, linear thinking, right? So if you were to listen closely to this right here, it says, for God to achieve his ultimate sovereign purposes, okay, he will at times providentially, right, allow things to take place that are outside of his preferences. This is because in his sovereignty, God will allow things he does not prefer in order to accomplish his ultimate plan. It is only when you understand the link between providence and sovereignty that you will become conscious of God's fingerprints in the midst of his apparent absence. God's fingerprints in the midst of his apparent absence. Turn with me to Genesis chapter 50. This gentleman by the name of Joseph is phenomenal, but when you apply these two phrases, God's sovereignty and God's providence, to Joseph's story, things start looking a lot more clear. Let us think about it for a second. Joseph is the descendant of God's chosen people. God chose Abram, and Joseph is a descendant, a direct descendant of Abram. Now, Joseph is also the youngest child out of all his brothers. And we know how younger children, the youngest child, get that extra love, right? Get that little bit more love. The Bible even records that his father loved him more than his brothers. So the Bible records that, you know, his brothers felt it firsthand, right? And that bred hatred inside of them. So not only does he love him so much, but this favorite child of the favorite child comes and he tells us that we're going to be bowing down to him. Not happening, right? So sure enough, they want to kill him, but then they decide to sell him. God's sovereignty, God's providence, keep paying attention, right? Instead of killing them, they sell him into Egypt. So here goes this child who had never thought about slavery, right? Never thought about any of that kind of stuff. He gets sold into slavery. He was having these dreams of people bowing down to him, but yet he's sold into slavery, the lowest place you could possibly be at that period in time, at any period in time, right? And sure enough, He rises out of slavery into a position in Potiphar's house. Now, we can't go too in-depth about Potiphar, but Potiphar is powerful. Very big man, head of security, on point. He gets to there, and now things are looking up. Praise the Lord, right? But all of a sudden, out of doing the right thing, he gets put into prison. Oh, man, God, what's going on? Sovereignty. Providence. He's in the jail, and now he's having dreams again. And he gives the interpretation to the two men. One's a cupbearer, and I can't remember what the other one is off the top of my head. But sure enough, the one that's not the cupbearer passes away, right? He's killed. But the cupbearer gets to go back to work, as it was interpreted from the dream Joseph had. Then Joseph sits in prison even longer, probably in much more dismay that the cupbearer didn't remember him or didn't try his best to get him out. God's providence, God's sovereignty comes into play. And the king has a dream that really disturbs him. The cupbearer finally remembers, oh yeah, somebody told me about a dream about me getting my job back. So you need to listen to his dream. He's in jail right now. They go and get Joseph. Joseph comes, interprets the dream for Pharaoh, not Potiphar, but for Pharaoh. And sure enough, Pharaoh says, well, if you got the answers, brother, why don't we just put you in charge of making it work? Okay. So sure enough, he rises from being the descendant of God's chosen person, chosen family. He goes into the depths of slavery. He rises out of that, then goes into the depths of prison, then rises out of that, become the third in command in Egypt, the greatest place in the world. And all these people were saved by his not only dream, but the discipline and the work ethic and everything that made Joseph the man of God that we love and that we adore. Okay. Now, also, here's where we pick up in the story. Genesis chapter 50. You see, his brothers came and they wanted to be saved as well, but they didn't want salvation from a spiritual sense. They wanted food. There was a famine in the land. And in that famine, not only was Joseph able to save all of Egypt, but Joseph was even able to save God's remnant, God's family that he actually set aside for his will and his purpose. God's providence, God's sovereignty. But his brothers, when they finally found out who Joseph was, they were terrified. Joseph, please don't hurt us, etc., etc. But look what Joseph says in verse 19, as most Christians would say when we're faced with certain issues. Whew. It says, and Joseph said unto them, fear not, for am I in the place of God? But as for you, you thought evil against me. But God meant it unto good, to bring to pass as it is this day, to save much people alive. Now, therefore, fear ye not. I will nourish you and your little ones. And he comforted them and spake kindly unto them. Family, that's our lesson for today, right? I can't go too in depth about God's sovereignty and his providence, but what I can do for you is to show you that as God's children, we have to trust in his sovereignty. No matter where this life takes us, we're supposed to take God's trust, his power, his joy, his safety with us, right? And we're supposed to make sure that we trust in him no matter where we go. But the thing is, sometimes it gets a little bit hard for us to look at God's sovereignty without respecting God's providence. Joseph says that, hey, God's sovereignty brought him or brought me to a place where I'm closer to him. All right. God's providence brought you to a place where even out of your evil, you are able to benefit because you never could have thought that God would put me here and put you there when you did your dirty deeds so many years ago. Family, as I close, I want you to think about this story. There's a woman whose parents were murdered by this man and he goes to prison for life. When he gets out, she forgives him and gives him a Bible. The lesson is not about the Bible that she gave him, but the lesson is in what she says next. She says verbatim, and I can't remember her name, but she says verbatim, I hated God. I was upset with God, but I learned that I needed God more than I needed to be mad at God. And family, that's why I want to leave you today. You need God more than you need to be questioning him. You need God more than you need to be upset with him. If you're dealing with loss, if you're dealing with confusion, if you're dealing with finance issues, trust me, I understand. But God understands more. So stay with him. Stay the course. Find a way to get closer and deeper with him so that he can clean you up. I love you with the love of the Lord. And if we want to trust and believe properly, we will trust in God's sovereignty and believe in God's providence. And he will take us to where he needs us to go. I love you with the love of the Lord, and until we meet again, peace.
Be thou my vision, O Lord of my heart. Not be all else to me, save that thou art. Thou my
thy presence my light. Be thou my wisdom and thou my true word. I ever with thee and thou with me, Lord. Thou my great Father, I thy true Son. Thou in me dwelling and I with thee one. Riches I heed not, nor man's empty praise. Thou my inheritance now and always. Thou and thou only first in my heart. My King of heaven, my treasure thou art. My King of heaven, my victory won. May I reach heaven's joys o'er bright and sun. Heart of my heart, whatever befall, still be my vision, O ruler of all.
Please bow with me. Lord, I thank you for this day, Father. I thank you for all the many blessings you've given us and just the ability to be able to worship you no matter the situation, Father. I pray for everything that's going on in this world, Lord, and I pray for the powers that be to make the right decisions as we move forward, Father, and hopefully are able to extend love and grace and patience and kindness to those around us, Lord. Thank you for your Son. In your name I pray. Amen.
Thank you for joining us today. We hope that this service filled with songs and prayers, a short message, but especially remembering the death and sacrifice of our Savior, has lifted your soul this afternoon. Listen, if you get a chance, join us on our Facebook page at Franklin Church of Christ TN or on our website at franklinchurchofchrist.com. Until next week, God bless you.